Hello, I'm Nick Grue with the National Renewable Energy Laboratory, and in this tutorial I'm going to discuss technical potential analysis. In this tutorial, we'll introduce technical terms and concepts for assessing resource and technical potential for energy planning activities. This tutorial will focus on solar and wind technical potential in the Web Geographic Information System platform named the RE Data Explorer. When talking about potential energy, we need to distinguish between different kinds of potential. First, we have resource potential, which is the theoretical physical potential. Then we have technical potential, which factors in system and topographic constraints, land use constraints, and system performance. Economic potential adds projected technology costs, while market potential factors in regional competition with other energy sources, policy, regulations, and investor response. In the RE Data Explorer, we generally only deal with resource and technical potential. To start out, let's describe what resource potential means. Resource potential can be either site-specific or non-site-specific. Site-specific resource includes solar, wind, and geothermal, in that electricity generation must occur at the site where these resources are available. Resources like biomass, coal, and natural gas can be transported from the site that they are available to locations where electricity is generated. Resource potential for site-specific resource is a layer showing where total resources are available and where they would need to be utilized. Resource potential for non-site-specific resources shows where resources are available, but does not indicate that these resources can be transported to a different site for use. Key variables for solar resource potential include direct normal irradiance, abbreviated to DNI, diffuse horizontal irradiance, abbreviated to DHI, air temperature, and wind speed. DNI is irradiance coming directly from the sun, while DHI is irradiance that has been scattered but can still be used for electricity generation. Air temperature and wind speed affect solar panel efficiency, and therefore also affects potential electricity generation. Key variables for wind resource potential include wind speed, wind direction, atmospheric pressure, air temperature, and hub height. Hub height is distance from the turbine platform on the ground to the rotor. Heights typically are 30 meters for distributed wind, 80, 100, 120, and 140 meters for utility scale wind. And in the future, you'll likely see even taller turbines for harnessing wind potential higher up in the air. When using resource data for finding potential, the spatial resolution of the data is important to consider. Wind resource, for example, generally has a high degree of spatial variability. This is due to the effects of hills, ridges, valleys, and plains on wind speed, meaning the higher resolution data available, the more likely the data will represent changing landscapes' effect on wind speed. Solar resource may have a high degree of spatial variability, or it may not. It depends on local and regional climate conditions. In the two images displayed here, the location on the right generally has a high degree of variability, which becomes less apparent further away from the epicenter, while the image on the left generally has similar resource across the area of focus. Now that we've discussed resource potential, let's take a closer look at technical potential. Technical potential is the achievable energy capacity and generation of a particular technology given sister performance, topographic limitations, environmental and land use constraints. The image on the right shows example datasets that can all be combined to focus on a particular areas with the greatest likelihood of development. It is important to note that technical potential does not consider technology costs. These costs are used in economic and market potential analysis. To determine the technical potential for a particular resource, you need to consider areas that are available for development. Datasets that can help reveal these locations include water features, urban areas, wetlands, slope, federal lands, and others. Once you have combined all available datasets, you end up with a single dataset showing available land area. With the available land area, we calculate the nameplate capacity. Nameplate capacity is the maximum amount of electric energy that a generator can produce under specific conditions, as rated by the manufacturer, generally represented in megawatts direct current. Nameplate capacity is calculated by taking the power density times the available land area. Power density is a number that generally defines the total capacity that can be built within a square kilometer of land. For fixed-tilt photovoltaics, for example, we generally use 32 megawatts per square kilometer. Wind, on the other hand, is less dense at around 3 megawatts per square kilometer. The reason wind has a much smaller power density is because you aren't able to pack turbines closely together for risk of reducing wind potential. These numbers are subject to change as technology advances. Now that we have the nameplate capacity for our land area, we need to calculate the likely generation of our land area for a single year. Generation is represented as megawatt hours or as a capacity factor. A capacity factor is the ratio of estimated system generation divided by its nameplate output. Laos, for example, has capacity factors that range between 11% and 18% for fixed-tilt photovoltaics. Now we have all the necessary inputs for calculating the technical potential, including available land area, nameplate capacity, and capacity factor. These three variables are multiplied by the number of hours in a year, 8,760, to generate the potential resource available, given technical constraints. Check out the next tutorials in this series on technical potential analysis, including assessing technical potential and using the technical potential tool in the RE Data Explorer. Thank you.